recording and share screen and fine. So next we're gonna see about overloading and overriding. So overloading, I think you would have got already some idea because we discussed that in constructors, right? So what we discussed is anything constructor which is differentiated in terms of number of arguments. So when you see overloading in terms of number of arguments or in terms of data type of the argument, if that is differentiated, methods having same name, okay, that is called overloading. Fine. Why we need such a overloading methods? Suppose if I define a class called math, okay, my math, okay, I am providing people with some methods to add method. Fine. Void, whatever there you pass, it will add and it will give you, it will print inside. Say for example, this is the method int a comma b. Fine. Suppose to add three numbers, again, if you do like this public static void add three int a comma int b comma int c, this can be done. But when you see here, this is not a good design. Like to add two numbers, to add three numbers, end of the day it's gonna add. Okay, so you need not differentiate with the different method names. So in order to avoid that, we can have a same method name, right, but with a different number of arguments is permissible in Java. That concept is called overloading. We are overloading the method with the same name. Okay, so when you call this method add, if at all you pass a two arguments, it will come to the method at a line number 22. If at all when you call this method you pass a three arguments, it will come to the line number 27. Okay, and similarly you can have like this also, public static void add double a comma double b. So if you pass a two arguments with decimals, it will come to line number 32. So what is happening when you design itself, the guy who gonna uses your class need not worry about different method names. He will just know what is add. He will call like my math.add of 2 comma 3, or my math, if I want to add three numbers, he will simply pass my math.add of 4 comma 7 comma 9. Okay, so when you do that, the design will be perfect and the usage will be easier. Okay, so this concept is called method overloading. Even if you want to add two decimals, he will not worry. He will simply pass with some decimals like 6.3, 7.2, whatever you pass, it will work. Fine. So this concept is called method overloading. So one thing you need to remember in terms of method overloading is when wait a minute, public, suppose I have something like static int void int a comma b, public static double void int a comma int b. Do you think method line number 38 and 42 are method overloading? If so, the answer is no. The reason is method overloading should be in terms of number of arguments or in terms of the data type of the argument. It doesn't matter with the return type at all. Got it? So return type int and return type double, that if that is a only difference, you can't say it is a method overloading. It's not, it's a compilation error. The compiler will not understand if whatever you call, sorry, add is a method name, right? The compiler will not understand whatever add method you call, right? It will not understand whether to go here or here. Got it? It works on the number of arguments or the data type of the arguments. Nothing to do with the return type. Fine. Don't ever forget this. Okay. So this concept is called method overloading. Okay. Whenever you write your own classes in future, okay. So where we end up in using these type of classes, whenever you write your own classes in future, say for example, I have a business need, there is a big class, you have a class to calculate some pay for a some HR or something, okay, so to calculate bonus or to calculate payment for the employers or class salary, some salary class is there. So you are into your project, they are giving some work to you, to quote something. Okay, there is a class called salary. Fine. In that class, what is happening? There is some logic which will return gross salary. Okay. And you have some code like int basic double HRA double int basic double HRA and one more thing double some PF. Okay, this is a class. So this class basically is a logic written basic into HRA into PF. Okay, now see here, guys, listen carefully. Now this is a class and you are into your Java project already. So they've given this class, some code is going to invoke the salary class. Since it is a static method, people will call like salary dot gross salary of some. So the how people will call this method, this is existing code in some other class. People will call like salary dot gross salary of, I will pass 10,000 comma HRA some 345.6 5 comma some PF amount. Okay, so this is a method you are calling. Now the requirement comes in. The requirement says that I am going to include a bonus as well, man. Okay, so now the bonus also should be multiplied, some bonus also should be added. Or okay, so with this the guys will be given bonus. The bonus should be like 10%. Okay, each month I am going to divide the bonus. Fine. So now how will you design this? What you do? I need to multiply a bonus also, or I need to add the bonus. Okay, so whenever I pass a three components, it is multiplying three components. Our bonus will be passed as a percentage itself, like into 0.10, into the exact amount where you can multiply, or you can just add it, bonus percentage. People will pass like 1.1 or 1.2, so that the overall amount will be calculated as a gross salary. Fine. So how will you, if at all given this thing, how will you code for this? Suggestions from you guys. People understand the situation, right, Shaji? Everyone.
So
yeah, so you
whether we will create
yeah. Better I create a
another class, another method with the same name but for
different arguments and
yeah. So better you end up in creating with the same name. When people pass the fourth argument, it is understood it is for the bonus. They will pass in terms of 1.1 or 1.2. You need to multiply. This is a logic. Okay. So now what will happen whenever I call with another method, this is a bonus, 1.1%. That means 110% is a bonus. So when you multiply, you will get a proper result here. So one, now you create another method and you will put like into bonus. Am I right? Yeah. But this also can be avoided. What can be done is, okay, what we generally can be done is we just put return bonus into this is what I want to explain. Got it? So whenever a new requirement is done, we make a overloaded methods. We add to the same method name and pass a new argument. Whatever logic you need to perform with that, we will call the existing overloaded methods. This is how things works. Got it? So what will happen? So this is a simple statement I did, right? But there can be n number of 100 lines of code, like lot of things can be there in real time project. Okay, so by calling this, right, what you are making sure is you are just making sure the already tested code is being called, already working code is being called. With that I am doing this logic. At the same time I am overloaded this method. When people call from outside, well, they never know, they will pass this, and with this you are calling the existing overloaded method. Got it? Any doubt,
Dave? Yes, sir.
Fine, right? So this is where overloading is frequently, or where I could see when in many of the projects, when someone gives a requirement, they will never bother about to touch the existing code. That's very dangerous, right? We will end up in lot of testing effect, regression effect. So what we do, we write our own overloaded method. and then you simply call the existing one. That's how things work. This is a real practical usage rather than explaining like theoretically like this. Okay, fine. So next one is like overriding. Overriding comes with inheritance concepts. Okay.
Before that, one question I have.
Yeah, sure.
So basically, we call the method using the class, the object name dot that method name, right?
Exactly, if it is not a static. So,
but in this case, you are directly using that gross salary inside that class.
Because that is static, right? So,
static.
Yeah. So we are using static. So static, when we discuss static, static doesn't come under instance itself. Remember, even when we declared a static variables, that is something like a global, right? So for every object share same thing, you need not have an object to access at all. Right.
So if they have not put an, like written static here, it will give a compilation error, right?
Yeah, this cannot be possible. If you don't put a static, you need to make like salary s equal to new salary s dot gross salary. Got it? You need to create an object, then only you can access this gross salary method. Fine.
Yeah. Okay.
So overriding is a concept where in an inheritance, right? Suppose I have some method in my base class. Okay, say class. Suppose you have a base class like log download. We discussed that example. So here you have some method which is nothing but protected void get bytes. Some method is there. Okay, download bytes. Fine. And now class torrent download extends download. Fine. And now here what I'm going to do in the torrent download class have this. Fine. Now there is torrent download t equal to new torrent download. Now when I put t dot, fine, will I able to access download bytes method? Yes or no? Yes, correct. Good. So since it's extends download and it is protected also with the reference of torrent download itself, that download bytes method can be accessed. Correct. Now what if you are using this? Okay, in the download method there are and 1000+ methods. Okay, the torrent download method uses about 600 methods here efficiently. Okay, but the download bytes method, right, we don't want to use it here. That means it is some, it found some logical error here. Fine. So at that point what torrent download can do? Okay, so whenever t dot download bytes is called by mistake or something, obviously it goes in the parent. So the torrent download doesn't have a control to change this logic also. The reason is the download is developed by some other guy. It is in some other jar. The torrent download class, whoever developing a torrent, don't want to rewrite all the code or reinvent the wheel again. So what they are trying to do, they are simply extends download. So they get all the 1000 methods can be reused here, or some attributes also can be reused. But the problem came where they identified the download bytes as some problem. So when in this scenario, what torrent download can do is, they can define a method with the same structure here. Okay, whenever in a parent class you are defining a method with the same name and same argument with same structure, right, that concept is called method overriding. Fine. So what you are telling is, when you call download bytes here, the child's download bytes only will be called. Suppose I have in sysout torrent download. Here I have another sysout in download. Fine. So now when I call t dot download bytes, it will print in torrent download. So it will go here. It will give the preference to its child class. Okay. So when you understand the concept, all the base class code will come to the subclass, right? If that is the case, this will be like both are same, right? There should be a compilation error, but that's not the case actually. What will happen is, if you define a same method with the same signature, with same arguments, and so the compiler and the Java code will think like you are overriding a method. Overriding is you don't want your base class or parents method to be used. For this name, when someone calls, I want my subclass method to be used. Got it? Fine. And suppose if I have one more method here, protected void method one. Okay. And here another method I have. Probably void method two. So these two are not at all interfered. This can be accessed quite easily here. You can put t dot method one is possible, t dot method two. Method two is from its own class, method one is from parent. No issues at all, it will work. But when you call t dot download bytes, it is there in both, right? So it will prefer the child's one. If you don't have a child's one, it will go for the parent's one. So that concept is called overriding. Fine. So it is extensively used. So whenever you want to reuse a concept, fine, and you think like there has been a lot of methods has been used very well, and one method where you feel like it's going something wrong, you can very well overwrite the method. Fine. Got it? Fine. One practical example. Yes, one practical example. Now you are given one more Java project. Fine. From some JSP page, you are passing from two text boxes are there, you are passing username and password. Through some servlet or something, one Java code is coming. That Java code name is security plugin. Say for example, you have a class called security plugin. Okay. So this security plugin class, what it does, it maintains session. Okay. So there are a few methods here. Public void maintain session. So in the session object, it will put all the things, and this is useful. And in another, public void logout session. These things are there, right? So these are some extensive code. Say you have about 100 lines of code, and here also you have 100 lines of code and well tested and already working. Fine. And now here one method is called public void authenticated. So whoever coming is authenticated. So this security plugin class currently, say for example, this guy's authenticate method calls a external service, one REST service, to check the username and password are correct. Fine. This is the existing code. Now the requirement came to you. You should deprecate the existing call. Deprecate is something you should not do this anymore. The service is going to shut down. Fine. Or for time being, shutdown means that happens around a period of time. On the day one itself, people will not shut down. Once you develop an alternative for this, once code is tested of your alternative, both will be in live at some point using wire on, wire off, putting some flag, this will be turned off. Correct? After some testing for a couple of months. Got it? So now this is your requirement. What you can do is, so how are you gonna authenticate is, you have your own DB. Okay? So the people telling, we come up with our own database. We should not depend on our authenticate method. But if you see, this maintain session and logout session are quite useful. It will keep track of the entire sessions, right? So now you should come up with design that you should authenticate in your own way. Okay, so what you do is, in these type of situations, you simply write a class called class DB security plugin, extends security plugin, right? And rest of the maintain session, logout session, you reuse it. What you do, you simply do public void authenticate. Here, you simply write down the code for connecting to DB and validate your username and password. Okay. So what happens now? In your implementation, wherever people call security plugin, you will simply put DB security plugin. But that won't be problem for a reference. The reference would have been already security plugin, right? So when you do this, since you are extending, you are able to reuse the maintain session and logout session. But only authenticate, it will prefer to its subclass. Got it? You will not removing this code. When things goes on live, right? For some time, this method will be tested. Once it is very well working for a couple of months, then this will be removed, or you can do some other thing. thing according to the time requirement. So this is one of the practical examples, right? So whenever you have a very large code and you are worried about to redefine or reinventing the wheel again, and you want to change a certain logic, you can very well extend it and prove it on your own. Fine. Internally also in Java, you have a lot of things that can be done with this type of inheritance. Say for example, when you learn Java Swing, right? Not Spring, Java Swing. Java Swing is like drag and drop, like displaying some text boxes. So it's a desktop app. Initially, what you do, some initial frame, you do a extends, you do a J frame. Okay, after that, you will define the border where my text box is there. So initial window, you just by extending it, you get all the code in your own class. You got it. So these are some examples. Fine. How you go for overriding and what is purpose of inheritance. Fine, guys. Any doubt you have?
No, sir.
All right. Cool. So the next thing is we're going to see about abstract class. Fine. When we discuss abstract class, before that we should learn polymorphism. Otherwise,
Ashok, will a class have a private or protected access specifiers?
Class cannot have a private actually. Again, protected also no, only public, or you can default. Default means, okay, it cannot be same thing within the same package. Public means it can be accessed, it can be imported anywhere. Okay, the other two things like private. Private you can have is as a within the class, okay, as a inner class. When we learn inner class, you will see private. Okay, so apart from that, when you define your own class, inner class means you can define a class inside a class, okay, so which is used for a specific purpose only. Fine. So when you try, not possible. Okay, within inside a class you can make private. There is no purpose of making a class private, right, with the same name, right? So what will happen? It's not possible at all, correct? Let me check it. Protected. No. Okay, so access specifiers are like private and protected are for only the attributes and the methods, okay? So it should be public, or you can leave as such. This is also possible. If you do this, okay, it cannot be accessed, this class cannot be imported outside the package. Fine, within the package only, right? So always make, whenever you create a class, as public. Got it? That is the purpose of actually creating a class. Fine. So private classes are possible when you write a class inside a class. What a class inside a class? Add is starting here, right? Main method is ending here. I can write one more class here. Private class inner. This will not come error. Don't worry, we will discuss about private inner classes later. Fine. Got it, Santosh?
Yeah.
Okay. 1 minute. Just a minute. So next what we're going to discuss about is polymorphism. Okay. So what is polymorphism? So this is very, very important concept. A lot of code works in this way. You need to listen very carefully. Okay. So now base class a reference pointing to subclass object. Fine. So what does it mean? So you have a base class, that reference pointing to a subclass object. What is the need for that? Again, the need for that is you need to clearly understand what is the difference between a reference and what is the difference between a object. Okay, suppose we were discussing that, right? Class download, Excel download, PDF download, and we were discussing about those classes. What you can do in polymorphism is download the base class reference, okay, which very well can point to its subclass object, new of PDF download. What is this and how it is possible? Yes, possible. The reason for that is PDF download is also a download, right? Because it extends download. That's why it's quite well possible. What is the reason for writing this is? This is the implementation part, okay? And this is the reference part. At any point of time, you can change this implementation whenever you want, okay? If at all now I write it as a PDF download, tomorrow if I think like, I will change it to Excel download. I will change it to text download. Whatever you want, you can change your implementation alone. Fine. So whenever I put PDF download D equal to new PDF download, I put D dot. Again, some method name, download method is there, which is there both in download and PDF download. When I put D dot download at a runtime, when the program is running, it will go to the download method of PDF download only. Got it? So that is where you see a pure polymorphic way. That means the object behaving in different ways, right? The reference behaving in different ways. So since when you see D dot download, even though there is a download method in download class and the download method is PDF download, you're accessing with download reference only, but the object, if you see, is a PDF download, it goes to the download method of PDF download. Got it? I'll show you guys with the examples here, otherwise it will be difficult to understand. Yeah, so see here, this is what we had, a statement download, right? We defined it in terms of constructors. We had a download method, URL and path, convert to Excel. Posting statement download, let me define like get void download in bytes, some method. Downloading in bytes, right? The same method I am going to use it here also. Downloading in bytes for Excel download. Next. Bytes for PDF download. Now if you see here guys, closely watch in this Eclipse editor, you could see a green color symbol here. What it tells? Overwrites. Okay, so this is already overwritten because downloading bytes is already there in the statement download class, correct? So in the child classes, I am defining the same name. That concept is called overwriting. You understood that already. Now, with respect to polymorphism, what I am going to do, so far you would have seen here, I am created an object for what? I'm creating object for only my child classes directly. Okay, the reference is also a child class. So what happens when you do a polymorphic way, like statement download st equal to new . So what does it mean? See, this is possible. This is what called polymorphism. Like this way of creating, you have never seen so far, right? So you would have seen that if a class A is there, A equal to new A. That's what you would have seen. Animal is there, animal A equal to new animal. But this is something interesting. You have some other reference here, some other thing here. That's what? This is a base class and this is a subclass. a base class reference pointing to a subclass object. So you should see what are the things if I put dot is accessible. When I put dot, what are the things that are available in a base class reference that only will display. Specific to a subclass will not ever display. What is specific to a subclass here? Convert to Excel, right? And we will see whether it is coming or not. SD dot. No, not at all coming. Fine. So then what is the purpose here? The purpose is the common methods you have, right, in the base class, and when it is overridden in a subclass, that is where polymorphism actually comes. So you have a download in bytes here, right? When I have a download in bytes, in compile time, when you click this here, it will take it here. Okay, it is taking to a method name called downloading in bytes. But when it actually the program runs, right, it sees a statement Excel download object and it will go to the statement Excel download bytes. In compile time, it will come here. Got it, right? In runtime, it goes to the particular subclass method because the object is the subclass. So it goes here. It goes to download in bytes of the subclass. The benefit of this is, right? So what is the benefit is this implementation, this way of object creation is decided at runtime. Okay. So instead of lot of putting lot of if elses, if you write more classes with the same method overriding, when you call at runtime, you will decide like which object will be triggered at runtime. So that concept is called polymorphism. Okay. So base class reference pointing to subclass object. So when I run this, see here, downloading, the rest of the things we discussed already. See, look at this only, downloading in bytes for Excel download. But when you click it here in Eclipse itself, you will see it goes to downloading in bytes. The concept here is it goes here directly to the here. So the benefit here is this code need not be changed. See, line number 16, I will not change. I will come here and I will change only this guy. And now see, this line is not at all changed and see how it behaves. An object behaving in multiple ways. That is what polymorphism. Line number 16 is actually what is being printed, right? It is not even changed. But here I am changing the implementation. So automatically it is printing the PDF download. Got it? So with the base class reference only that is possible, because the reason is the base class is capable of pointing to Excel download or also pointing to a PDF download, because these two guys also a statement download, right? So that is how it typically works. Fine. Let me give you one more.
I could not follow, Ashok.
Yeah, you need to understand more clearly here. Fine. So did you understood that definition, like a base class reference pointing to subclass object?
Yeah, definition understood.
Yeah. So we have different number of classes here. So first I have a class called statement download. Fine. In the statement download class, have one constructor statement download with an overloaded constructor with an empty constructor. These things we discussed already. The statement download class have a download method and a download in bytes method. Couple of things is already there here, right? Fine. And now what we are doing is we are writing our statement Excel download, which extends statement download. Okay. So we are overriding download in bytes method. Till that point clear, what is overriding and what we have done here? Are confused?
Clear.
Clear. Are you sure?
Yeah, the download in bytes is in the main class.
Yeah, it is in statement download class. It's a base class. Right? Okay. And in your children statement Excel download, I have download in bytes again. Fine. And convert to Excel, it is not in base class. This method defines to the subclass alone. Got it? For the child alone, the convert to Excel method is there. Okay. And download in bytes is there in both. Got it? In statement download as well as in statement Excel download. That's why it is called overriding. And in statement download, you have specific to download. Download is a specific to statement download. Now you got it, right? A download method is there, which is there only in base class. A download in bytes method is there, which is there in both base class and subclass, right? Convert to Excel method is there, which is only in subclass. Till this point is clear? the structure, what I have done, right? The three methods. One method is only base class, one method in only subclass, one method common to both. That's why that method alone is overriding. That's why when you see here, a green color symbol is coming here, right? So it overrides this method, which is called downloading bytes. Fine. Now, what we're going to do, the same thing I have done for PDF also, PDF download also, same concept. Now, polymorphism is a way of using, with the use of a base class reference, because subclass is also a statement download, right? When you see statement PDF download, it's a statement download, correct? And statement Excel download is a statement download. Statement download, right? Because why I say insert statement download is whenever you see a parent class, base subclass extends a base class, right? The subclass also a parent class. Am I correct? So all the properties comes there. Fine. We call this also a is a relationship, right? Fine. So now, base class reference can very well point to a subclass object. So far, whatever you have seen, right, in everywhere in Java, you could have seen that these type of statements like line number 10. You would have never seen like line number 14. What is this? It should be both sides same, right? Why it is different? That is called polymorphism. A base class reference is there, which can very well point to a subclass. You cannot do with a class A and class B, which is not at all related. That's not possible. If at all class B extends A, then only this is these type of things can be written, right? So base class reference I have done here, and my implementation is my subclass. Okay. So whenever I put SD dot, the benefit of this is I have shown you this also. SD dot, whenever I put, the reference is a base class, right? The remote control is a base class. Whatever they are configured in the base class only will come here. Got it? But when the program runs, okay, it sees the implementation is its subclass, not its base class. It directly goes to its subclass implementation when it only at runtime. Okay. So when you have a common methods where polymorphism is effective, when you put SD dot, right, I don't even get convert to Excel method. If you see, you guys, I never get convert to Excel method, even though the object is statement PDF download. Doesn't matter. The reference is capable of having a statement download only, right? The compiler thinks at compile time, right? The compiler thinks at compile time, when I click this, it thinks it should go here. Where it is going? In statement download, in my parent class. But at runtime, you have a new of statement PDF download, right? Runtime, it sees the this SD is pointing to its subclass implementation. In runtime, it will not go here. See the output. In runtime, it will go to the subclass. That means statement PDF downloads implementation. It will print downloading in bytes for PDF download. Okay. So why it is being done? What is the use? The use behind it is the line number 16. I am not even changing at all. Right, without changing line number 16, this is a method, this is a line which is responsible for printing it. Without changing this, what I am doing, I am can change the implementation and very well run the code. I will have no issues at all. Okay, I will getting that particular implementation message here. Got it. So this concept is called polymorphism. I will show you with one more example. So let us have a class called animal. Fine. Let me have one method in animal, which is make noise. Fine, I have an animal is making noise. Tiger. Lion. One more thing called so each and every class extends animal. So everywhere I am going to overwrite this, make noise. Make noise is a common concept of an animal, right? So what I am going to do here, tiger is making noise. Here, lion is making noise. Here, elephant is making noise. Here, animal is making noise. Fine. And now in animal, what I am going to do, protected, void, eat. Animal is eating. Over here, I'm not going to define that. And here, protected void run. So run is a specific method to elephant. Say for example, elephant is running. Say for example, for lion, right, void chase. Lion is chasing, right? It's sleeping. Okay, that's it. So you have everything ready now. Fine. So actually speaking, creating an object for animal class is useless. The reason is, what is an object should be a real entity, right? Real concrete class. If you're creating an animal object, that doesn't make sense in real world, right? So we created a class called animal to have in order to reuse some methods. That's it. Okay. So normally what in industry people will do is they will create objects for subclass only. Okay. Because that is what the actual implementation, what you want. If you what animal you want, you will say it's an elephant, lion or tiger. You cannot simply, animal is a generic thing, correct? You cannot say I want an animal, right? So let me create a test class. Okay, now if you see, I can very well ask the user, okay, sys out one. I can display, I want tiger, I want lion, and for 3 I want elephant. Again, so here, enter your choice. Fine. So, don't worry about this code, I just want to show you the benefit of polymorphism. CH not equal to 4. Exit. So fine. So here what I will do, scanner is equal to new scanner. I am putting it over in a loop. Again it will display me a choice. Enter your choice, what you want. You want a tiger, you want a lion, or you want an elephant, or you want to exit, right? So user will, ch is a variable, I am getting a choice as an input. Next thing, right? So once this is done, I am going to put a switch case, switch ch. In case one, what I want, case one is nothing but I want a tiger, correct? If the user presses one, it comes here. In case one, I'm going to have a tiger, right? As my animal. So what I can do here is, I can very well write one method. Public static void making noise, one method here, which is a private local method here. I can pass an animal. I can simply call a dot make noise. Fine. See here, an animal reference, anyone can pass an animal reference here, right? And that guy pass an make noise here. Got it? So what I can do here, in case one, I can simply call making noise of new of tiger. Okay, and I can break in case two making noise of new of lion and break again in case three making noise of new of elephant break again case four nothing right case four break default invalid choice entered okay now see this code so when the user presses one right making noise method is being called the making noise method doesn't know what implementation it will come at even at runtime right only at runtime it knows whether it comes a tiger whether it comes a lion whether it comes a elephant do you see this code is changed no it simply calls a dot make noise this is try to understand this is what called polymorphism is all about okay and base class object is pointing to subclass objects at runtime it, base class object never knows what it is being doing so this object behaving in different ways at runtime right so what is happening when I call a dot make noise its animal is making noise right but actually when runtime what is happening based upon the user choice without changing this code much okay I'm able to put whether it is a tiger whether it is a lion whether it is an elephant right based on that I can decide what subclass can be put it over here this is a very simple example with one line what if I have a thousands of line here a common code okay at when running the code I can decide what object can be put it over here don't worry about what we don't worry about this line what is this new of tiger what does it mean okay whenever you pass an argument to a method right this will be assigned to this this is nothing but animal a equal to new tiger because here you have animal a I am calling at making noise only right so animal a equal to new of tiger animal a equal to new of lion animal a equal to new of elephant so when you run the code right while running when the user presses case 1 okay the tiger object will be injected there right so it comes here at runtime it goes to make noise of tiger object okay there is no sense for creating an animal object in these type of examples an animal is just to give a one way of you reusing certain methods that's it again if I put a dot because when you see in this method animal this method doesn't know which animal actually will come in it will know only at the runtime right when I put a dot it will have eat and make noise alone it doesn't have a method specific to tiger then if you want a method specific to tiger to be used then you have no way of using an animal reference you should use tiger t equal to new tiger if you want to use a specific things to a tiger to be used okay but your requirement is to have a things that can be used across both right so you can pass a new tiger you can pass a new lion you can pass a new elephant at runtime it will decide so when I run this code right when I press 1 so what will happen the code will come here ch is 1 case 1 it goes here then only it realizes it's a tiger so this tiger object will be passed a dot make noise will take to the tiger's object see here tiger is making noise but at compile time when I click it goes here right so when I press 2 so what is happening it's a loop right that's why it's asking me again a chance so it comes to case 2 now a lion object is being passed so lion is making noise right when I press case 3 elephant is making noise and exit got it guys the benefit is at runtime only you will realize so what object is coming in and what can be called so you will have your code very much neat and you can make this type of behavior got it
so Ashok Ashok like this is like this reference as we discussed earlier it will be stored in a stack
exactly
right
exactly
so this can be reused to point multiple objects
exactly right? Perfectly done yes
okay. Okay
perfect multiple objects of its heredity I got it of its okay. subclasses you cannot have a class a class b which at all not at all related and certainly pass it is a typecast exception even in compile time itself it will not allow okay. got it so its subclasses okay. any subclass can use it okay what actually in industry
so we are saving memory also correct
yeah saving memory the main don't think of saving memory here at all in java Okay, the main purpose is to have a OOPS type of coding, okay, object-oriented coding, and to have a very clean code rather than more if-else, to have more maintenance easy, right? Very clean code rather than to have a main.
Instead of coding many things, we are just coding that one only.
Maintenance will be very easy. Maintenance is very easy. If at all, because of these classes, what is happening is, I think you are almost there. You are almost good in now understanding. Okay. Fine. So if at all, if a requirement comes tomorrow, I want a peacock as a new requirement. I want to know how a peacock is making noise. So how will you code now? What you will do? What are the changes you will do in this code? It's quite easy, right? You are almost there, you are telling.
Yeah, we have to add one more.
Like
tiger lion, we have to add for peacock, and we don't need any other changes there.
Exactly, that's what my point. So making noise logic is this, right? We are not even touching it, we are not even bothering it. See the amount of code change you are introducing with the help of, by of a new requirement comes in. That is what the entire industry is struggling, right? Maintenance of code. No need of worrying about the memory, nothing. Lot of memory is cheap these days, even RAM, right? They are putting lot of servers, they don't want to, everyone is running after, if any issue comes in live, how fast you react and how fast you fix in the code, right? If any requirement comes, how fast the development. That's why everyone is moving along, correct? So, as we discussed, when a new requirement comes, peacock, correctly said by you, you will add a new class here. And you will simply put a one more case, that's it, over. Actually, making noise code is never touched. The other classes are not disturbed. If you don't develop in these type of classes, if you don't establish a polymorphic relationship, what you will end up in doing is, you will end up in putting another if else, right? If this is a case, I'm going to create in this object, I'm going to, you write a lot of junky code will develop, right? Regression testing has to be done. So all these things are avoided here. Got it? Fine. So
the new tiger of bracket you're giving, right? That's an object you're passing, right?
Yes, that's an object. It's a constructor, obviously, right? That's an object.
So we can also do tiger t is equal to new tiger and then pass t in the bracket, right? That also is valid, right?
Perfect. Perfectly valid. You're passing it. Anyhow, t also will points to the same object, right? No issues for you at all, right? Anyhow, t also pointing to same object. We'll never get an error. Okay. But the point I thought here is, I'm not going to use T anywhere here. Okay. I'm going to use only the K. But you could see here, animal A equal to, this line will be converted as animal A equal to T. Right? When you see animal A equal to T, it is not that T is pointing to some object in heap. The same object here also will point. That's it. Got it?
Yeah. In case one, we can put like this, right? Animal A is equal to new tiger, right?
That is also possible. Yeah. So in that case, animal A equal to new tiger means here it will be animal A equal to A. But the left side A is a local variable, right? Which is in the stack of making noise. The right side A is another local variable which is in the case. But that doesn't matter. When assignment happens, animal A equal to A, wherever the A here pointing, this A also will point to the same thing. Got it?
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so that's how it works. Fine. Clear, guys, why we need polymorphism? Because this is a very important concept. Okay, so this is actually where the OOPS gets its real shape. Encapsulation, inheritance, nothing. Okay, so those are you will see, those are just concepts, rules. But here where actual design principles and design talent will develop here. So how we will go into the classes. Whenever a requirement is given, you need to go in this way. Fine. Any doubts?
Ashok, can you go to the top of the page?
Top, yeah. Yes, Santosh. Any doubts you have here?
So here we are not extending anything from the animal class.
Why we need to extend here? See, think the design stops from animal, elephant, lion, tiger. That's it, right? We are testing how things are works here, animal test. That's why we have a public static void. Okay. If you're going to extend, we need not even create an object for those things, right? Correct. Yeah. So there is no need of extending it at all. Okay. See, in real-time code, this code making noise and this case switches need not be here. It can be in a JSP page also, right? In a web page, I can have a button, right? I can have four buttons, tiger. On click of tiger, I will put a new of tiger object to this making noise method. On click of lion, I will pass a new of lion object to this making noise method. On click of elephant, I will pass a new elephant of this making noise method. This make noise method itself, I can define in some other class. Okay, in a JSP or in some button, on button click, I can pass an object what I need. Got it, right? So this is my design, animal, elephant, lion, tiger. This is my design, right? So in order to this design works, I'm testing this code.
Got so it? As long as it's in the same class, same package, and the class is public, we can access it.
We can access it very well. See, that's what we did for everything, right? So far, if you see all the code, whatever we did, not only here. In animal test, we created an animal. I showed you example of encapsulation and all, right? In encapsulation and all, what we did actually? We created a class and we created this class to test how it works. Correct or not? That's it. The same way. As long as it not only within the same package, even outside the same package, if all these guys are public, very well, you can access those. Not at all an issue. Got it? Animal test, if very well all these four classes, animal, elephant, lion, tiger, okay, all these four classes are public. If you can define a test class anywhere. See, how a real coding works is, I am a team from some US, okay? So I am a team which develops a core logic. I am a core logic team. I am an architect, say for example. What I will do, I will give a design to you. Okay, I will develop the animal class Dumai. I developed the elephant, lion, tiger. This is the code. I will give it to you as a jar. You will add this jar in your build path. Okay, now to use this code, what you do, you will do like this. That's it. Got it? Someone will develop this actually. Animal, elephant, lion, tiger. You will develop how to use this. Fine. Since they are already done in a polymorphic way, you write a code like this. Suppose if you are doing in an HTML page, you will put a submit button, four submit buttons. On click off of a submit button, instead of this case 1, case 2, you will have actions triggered for each submit button, right? On click off submit button 1, on click off submit button 2, on click off submit button 3. On each on click, you will call this method, right, by passing a new tiger. That's it. End of the day, there should be one app, right? There should be one code, right? Correct or not? Fine.
Yeah.
So that's how it actually works. Suppose you have say for example, you have some Android app. Fine. And in that Android app itself, you have some game. Okay. Play. Wrestling. Play. Cricket. Play. Volleyball. Fine. This is the first page that Android app comes. So what you would have done? You would have designed three buttons. You would have drag and dropped three buttons, right? Play wrestling, play cricket, play volleyball. Okay. That is your first screen. So in those type of application, on click of a submit button, you will trigger an action. You will trigger a code what needs to be done. So you will have, when you click a play wrestling button, you will have one method. Void on click play wrestling. So whenever you click a play wrestling button, your code starts here, okay? And suppose you will have a jar to use. So one class called game, okay? Another class, you have class play wrestling extends game. Got it? Mm-hmm. And you have one more, okay, here you have. And here what you do is, suppose there is a method in another class play game, like a method I wrote here, right? Similar to this, there is a method here in a play game class. So in this class, I'm writing a method void play game, start game or something. So what this takes as an argument, this takes a game as an argument. So it doesn't know which game you actually pass. You pass g dot. Suppose in all the classes, you have a method called void started. Okay. In Rustling also you have a method called void started. So this is overriding, right? Here I have g dot started. Fine. Now this is a code which is given to you from line number 193 to 217. Someone developed this code and given to you. Okay. Now you are writing one app for it. You designed three simple drag and drop buttons. One drag, second drag, and third drag. Three submit buttons. First submit button, when you click, the submit button is play wrestling. Second submit button is play cricket and play volleyball. Okay, when you click play wrestling, the action triggers here. On click play wrestling. So how will you call this code now here? Right? So how will you call this code? You want to, you know, very well know you will need to start the game. You need to call this one. So how will you do? Play game is a normal class. Okay, so assume it's a public class. So what you need to do, you need to create an object for play game. Play game pg equal to new play game. Right? You very well know this class is, this method is triggered only when the user presses play wrestling button, right? So what you will do, pg dot start game, right? Pg dot start game of which object you will pass, new wrestling. So automatically when you pass a new wrestling here, where the code goes, play game, the code comes here wrestling object started, where now the code goes, it goes to the wrestling class and it will execute the code here in started. So in started, maybe a wrestling screen can come, two people can fight, lot of code will be there, right? And here maybe in this, in another, maybe cricket, in started method, a pitch can come, 12 players, 11 players can come, and it can have those type of screens. But how your code looking like, very neat, right? On click play wrestling, you have this only, menu of wrestling. On click play cricket, you will just start cricket wrestling. So where there is public static void in here, nothing, right? There is a existing design is there and you are using that design in your own on click buttons, correct? Fine. Do you think your on click play wrestling, whatever you write within that particular class, should extend all these guys? No, right? You just want to create the object for this guy and pass whatever object you want. Things will happen automatically because this has been designed in that way. Understood everyone the benefits of classes and how polymorphism works? Shaji, Mahilesh.
Yeah, but we need to practice to make it concrete.
Yes, obviously. Okay, because that's what I told, right? So one point, without Eclipse you cannot go. The other point is people just buy head first Java book. Okay, this one. So we covered a lot of topics. At first, Java textbook. Okay. So at first Java, Kethi Sera. Surely after these classes, you will 100% understand if you go through this book. In that, you can very well go through what they tell by encapsulation. Because now you all people know what is the difference between a reference and what is the difference between an object. You are able to understand here. I'm very happy, like what I am trying to say here is, you people understood till this point. Okay, that means when I pass a tiger here, you are able to understand it's animal A equal to new tiger here. So only thing is, you need more deeper understanding. That comes when you learn by a book and also when you practice more. Rather than learning by a book, when you practice more, when you hands-on coding. But before going to hands-on coding, get this book, guys. Okay, Head First Java by Kethi Sera. In that you can very well go through encapsulation, inheritance and polymorphism concepts. Okay, directly don't go from page number 1 and all. Go to this chapter, learn encapsulation, try to understand what they are trying to say, or even before, classes and objects. Okay, constructors. Okay, encapsulation, inheritance, polymorphism. These 5 things. Okay, you should be very thorough. You can go through the textbook. Okay, I will share the recording of this. You can see this recording and create your own classes, right? Similar to that, and try out with the hands-on. Then only you will be shaping up to this point before we move on to the next concepts. Got it?
Yeah.
So the concept wise you understood, right? Why it is used and how it is.
Yeah.
Fine. So spend some time in learning all these things. Okay, so more of practice you people need.
Okay, sir. Yep.
Fine. Okay, guys, I will share the video today itself. Okay, so the people can practice. So do you need a class tomorrow or need some break to practice this?
We need some break, maybe.
Sure. Okay, fine. All right. Yeah, obviously you need to set up something and you need to practice these things, right? You can practice the same example, right? So whatever we discuss, you can create this itself. You can create a class called game and you can create this, all these things, play game and everything. And you can create a public static void main. You can create a class called game, wrestling, cricket, football and everything. And just write some simple methods and try to use those classes with the help of polymorphism and try to override it. And try to put your own constructors and try, it's more of you try many things, you will get confidence. Got it?
Yep.
So without doing that, when you come for a next class, it's waste of our time and waste of your money for sure. Got it?
Yeah.
Okay. So you just try it up and you people just message me when you're all confident, right? Maybe in, we cannot keep like that, okay? Otherwise, you will never study. Maybe on Saturday, we will have class.
Okay. Yeah, that is what we are thinking.
I think
otherwise, that, like, we will be having a vague idea. We can be like,
you will never actually.
So we have to practice more.
You just practice. Okay, we will do one thing, okay? If you people don't mind, okay, like, you people can practice code in your machine, okay? Like for the next class, you can take this itself as an assignment. Create a class called game with a wrestling, cricket, football, and practice all the overriding, overloading, and as well as constructor, as well as polymorphic concepts with this game, okay? Class game design, right? Got it? And now, you everyone practice in your own computer. Okay, next class what we will do, we will spend some half an hour of our class time in discussing what mistakes you do. I can make you people, each and every guy as presenter, and see what you do, what errors you get. Okay, we will rectify each one. Everyone will look into other code as well, so each one can guide you after our sessions as well, because you are friends, right? Okay, so that can be done before we move on to the next topic. Got it? Yeah, so don't worry, like, your half an hour is wasted. So if you do that, I will also gain confidence, you people also will gain confidence, right? So by seeing your code, we can understand what you have done, whether you have understand, so can I explain more. Fine. Got it? Yeah, sure. So we can have it on your today is Wednesday night, right? What about your when can we have Saturday night, your Saturday night, because you will have Saturday morning fully to prepare. That's my thought.
We will just have it.
We'll try that. We don't know actually whether we'll get time, we'll be busy with some other thing.
Okay, okay.
So,
getting it. Okay,
so we'll try our level. We'll schedule our class for Saturday morning, our Saturday morning.
Yeah.
Actually, Saturday I'm going out actually.
Oh, so Saturday your night you will not be available.
My night I will not be available. It will be late to my home. If at all you people are like maybe my time like night 10 or 10:30 I can stay, but that will be like your afternoon, I think, if you don't have plans.
What about Sunday early morning, our morning?
That is fine. That can be done.
Your Sunday night.
Yeah. No
that
problem.
Will be fine.
Early morning. Sunday early morning means you are 7:30, right? Normally,
yeah,
or you are 7 o'clock.
Seven.
You people wake up Sunday 7 o'clock. My God. Okay. So 7 o'clock means 4:30 evening for me. That's very well fine.
Right? 7 to 9, right? 7 to 9, right?
Yeah.
So that will be 4:30 to 6:30. Can be done.
Yeah.
Yeah, we will fix that. So you have now 3 days of time. Please. Nothing, only 2 hours needed from your normal schedule to understand, to go through this video and practice. Okay.
Yeah.
Surely we will discuss the code in each and every of your machine before we move forward. Okay.
When you will upload
whatever the next concepts we'll go through, will all those are dependent on the OOPS concept only from now on?
Yes, obviously. That's why I'm asking you to practice before we move on. Correct. Okay, so each and one, everything is extension, right, of other concept. The next is extension of inheritance. The next is extension of polymorphism. It goes in that way. So if you have, you need a hands-on of this before we move on for sure.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So we will.
So what are the? Can you just give the name of the topics?
Pending concepts. Is it?
Yeah.
You have abstract class. You have interface. You have collection framework. Okay. You have threats. You have inner classes. Before that, we need to see has a relationship also. Okay, abstract class, inheritance, collection framework, thread, inner class. Yeah, this is most of core Java. Okay, if you learn till this itself, you can manage core Java. Okay, you can very well manage. So the major concepts in core Java lies in inheritance, polymorphism, encapsulation, constructor, abstract class, interface, collection framework. That's it. Yeah, you can very well.
And in advanced Java, you cover JQE and all.
Yeah, 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 we will discuss that. Let us complete this fully. Okay.
No, just checking.
Yeah, yeah, it's a lot of things. You will, you people will afraid now. See, a lot of topics there. You have REST, you have JSP, you have servlets. A lot of concepts are there. You don't want to get into it. We will finish it off first. Okay.
Okay.
Okay guys, I will upload the video in another maybe 5 to 6 hours before you wake up. Fine.
Okay, sir. Yep.
Okay. Thanks. Thank you.
No, thank you. Bye. Bye.